Our gospel reading today comes once again from the Gospel of John and follows very shortly after the story that we read last week of the feeding of the 5,000. It's directly dependent on an understanding of that story where Jesus takes 5 loaves and 2 fish and miraculously feeds the crowd. So hear these words. The next day, the crowd saw that had stayed on the other side of the sea. There had been only one boat there. They also saw that Jesus had not got into the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Then some boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus on the other side of Galilee. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to Jesus, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to Jesus, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to Jesus, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Please pray with me. Might words spoken and words heard, and the spaces in between, remind us of your love. Amen. Many years ago, more years than I want to stop and count, I served as the minister of Christian education at a church in Concord, Massachusetts. The church was located just down the street from a group home for developmentally disabled adults. And several of the men who lived there, including an older fellow named Ralph, worshipped with our congregation every week. Ralph saw himself as the church's official greeter. Even though various folks would volunteer every week to stand at the sanctuary doors and welcome people to worship, just as we do here, Ralph always made sure that he was dab smack in the middle of the stairs going up into the sanctuary, always right there, right in the middle, unavoidable. Now, you need to understand a little bit about Ralph. You need to understand, first of all, that he was often very poorly shaven. His clothes were, shall we say, less than stylish in this upper-class community. And he always, always had a pipe clenched between his teeth. I don't remember ever seeing him without it. Even during the service, there was the pipe. I don't ever remember seeing him light it either, but nonetheless, he had it in his mouth. I suppose some people were put off by Ralph. He may have even scared off a visitor or two. Ralph was usually accompanied by his friend Francis. Francis was a short little fellow, rather rotund, very quiet. They both were probably in their 50s at the time. Ralph did most of the talking for them. And over time, folks got used to their presence and actually asked for Ralph and Francis when they were absent. Ralph, Francis, and their housemates would always attend the 10:45 service and sit together, God bless their souls, in one of the pews down near the front. Would that more Christians do the same. They could be counted on to sing loudly and usually off key, but with a sense of genuine joy. They seemed to listen intently to the sermon, though Francis often fell asleep. And like many other adults there and here, they seemed to get more out of the children's moment than the sermon. The only real issue was Holy Communion. The church had an open table, just as we do here. And all were invited to partake. And as we most often do here, communion was served to folks as they remained seated in their pews. You know, those trays with the tiny little, I like to call them shot glasses, forgive me. And then trays filled with cubes of Wonder Bread, well, that was upper class. It was probably Pepperidge Farm. By the time we got to communion, it was almost noon. And the group home followed a pretty strict schedule when it came to meals. Lunch was always served at noon. So the guys, by the time we got to communion, were pretty hungry. Breakfast had been a long time ago. Francis in particular, you could hear his stomach rumble. And when that tray of bread would go by, he wouldn't just take one tiny cube like other folks. He'd grab a whole handful and pop them in his mouth one after the other, right there in the front pew. Our deacons were beside themselves. Month after month, they would ask, what should we do when that happens with Francis? How should we handle the bread problem? And for month after month after month, it went unresolved. Until we decided to really have a discussion about it. And that's when we decided what was needed was some education. You see, Ralph and Francis and their friends, this was in the early 80s, had often been left out of church from the very get-go. As children, both Ralph and Francis had been institutionalized. They'd never had the opportunity to go to Sunday school or attend a confirmation class. They'd never learned about things like communion and baptism. Their parents had been told to hide them away. Often they hadn't even been exposed to the Bible stories that most every church goer knows from the time they're that high. So we decided to start a special program that we called Sunday Fellowship. We opened the doors to all those who wanted to be a part of the experience, and twice a month we gathered for fun and food and fellowship and even a bit of worship. Don't misunderstand, we still very much wanted Ralph and Francis and the others to attend regular worship, but this would give them tools that would allow them to participate more fully. It was like a resource room. And it all started because of the problem with the bread. The teachings of Jesus in today's lesson from John all grow out of the problem with bread. Just prior to the incidents in our passage, Jesus had performed the miracle of the 5 loaves and 2 fish. He had provided for a crowd of 5,000 men and untold numbers of women and children, and then some. There were lots of leftovers. The crowd is so impressed they want to make him king. John tells us Jesus didn't want to be king, so he snuck off, not wanting to be thrust into such a position. And eventually he ends up on the opposite side of the lake. The crowd is not about to be put off, however, so they pursue him and discover where he is. But Jesus is on to them. "I know why you're here," he says. "I gave you handful after handful of bread. You need to be looking for bread that doesn't get moldy. Bread that doesn't dry out. Bread that doesn't last. You need to be looking for bread that doesn't go bad." No doubt they scratch their heads. And they look at one another and they wonder, just what does he mean? We need to be looking for bread that doesn't dry out and go bad. "Trust me," he says. "Trust the way I am showing you to live in my teachings." "Okay," they reason, "but give us some proof that you're sent from God, that this is the way to live. Show us another sign. After all, Moses didn't just give them manna once. They got manna every day and quail on top of it." Jesus shakes his head. I've always imagined Jesus did a lot of head shaking. "They just don't get it." He points to himself. "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever trusts in me will never be thirsty." They still don't get it. They don't understand his metaphor, his analogy. They're still thinking with their stomachs and not their hearts. Grab a whole handful of bread made with flour and yeast and you'll still be hungry. If not now, then it's supper time. And that deep down hunger, that hunger that lies beneath it all, that hunger that is not merely physical but spiritual as well, that hunger, that longing to be loved, that hunger that is in the gut of every single human being, that will never be solved, that will never be filled with a slice of whole wheat or a glass of Chardonnay. It'll never be satisfied with making lots of money or or becoming famous or anything. Nothing will satisfy that except for love. The love that comes from knowing God, the love that comes from living God's way. My way, says Jesus. Do you want to live a life that's more satisfying than a five-course meal? Then pay attention, he says. I am the bread of life. And they still don't get it. The verses that follow our passage tell us that they question and doubt and argue and complain, and they take his metaphor all too literally. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? They ask at one point. Long after Jesus is gone from the face of the earth, it happens again when the Romans accuse Christians of being cannibals. No doubt misunderstanding the symbolic nature of communion and its talk of the bread and wine as the body and blood of Christ. And such misunderstandings persist. When I was very first in ministry, I was leading a Sunday school class and we were discussing the meaning of Holy Communion. One young girl, about 13 or so, shuddered when I said communion. Oh, I never take communion, she said. Why not? I asked, assuming that someone had told her she couldn't because she was too young. She paused, wondering if she could trust me. And then, internally deciding she could, she said, "You won't catch me drinking blood." I am the bread of life, says Jesus. And to this very day, we often fail to see the point of his analogy. He's, of course, not being literal. He doesn't mean anything physical by it. He's not even talking about communion. That hadn't even been invented when Jesus was around. But even as bread is often called the staff of life, even as bread is said to be essential to one's physical health and well-being, so too the love of God made known in and through the way of Jesus is essential to life. For that love of God is why you are alive. It is what sustains you. It's what gives you breath itself. You can't live without it. And that love is made real, is made manifest every time human beings connect with one another. Every time human beings remember to be kind and compassionate and just and graceful. Every time that happens, God's love is made real. Every time we reach out to those who are different, we are sharing the bread of life. That's what we were trying to do with that Sunday fellowship program so many years ago. Out of curiosity, I went to the church's website this past week to see if Sunday fellowship still exists. I was invited to speak at the 25th anniversary of that program. But that was some 13 years ago now, and things do change, especially in the church. But when I pulled up the website, there it was, pictures of men and women engaging in the various activities that have marked that program over the years, including leading the annual Epiphany Sunday service with their reenactment of the story of the wise men. You've never heard that story unless you've heard it Sunday Fellowship's way. Sunday Fellowship, reads the website, is an ecumenical ministry of worship and fellowship for all abilities. It was founded in West Concord Union Church in 1982 to welcome neighbors with developmental delays and has grown into a vital part of our church community. A vital part of our church community. Some participants are members of West Concord Union Church, and some participate in other faith communities in addition to Sunday Fellowship. We gather two Sundays a month that concludes at 4 p.m., sharing joys and concerns, singing songs, learning about God's love, and engaging in creative activities together. Did it really address the bread problem? Oh, yes. But not just on Communion Sundays. For in the end, it was and still is all about the love of God. And that, my friends, that